Good afternoon. Hello. Did you all have some of our sandwiches out there and potato chips and water and everything? You can continue eating while the people put on the presentation, so don't think you have to stop eating. My name is Don Manzullo. I'm the president and CEO of the Korea Economic Institute of America, and I'm delighted to welcome you here today. This is going to be a very interesting panel discussion on economic relations with North Korea. You'll probably get about 35 different viewpoints and wonder why so many viewpoints, and that's because there are at least 35 different viewpoints that I'm aware of on an extraordinarily interesting, very difficult, and obviously very timing subject. The program is part of our academic symposium through which KEI has traditionally organized panels at academic conferences. This is the first time we're hosting an academic symposium panel in Washington, and it certainly is timely given the recent developments taking place in North Korea. Papers produced from this panel will be included in the 2016 volume of KEI's Joint U.S.-Korea Academic Studies publication, which will be released within a few months. I'd like to give special thanks to Professor Gil Rosman, our editor-in-chief of the Joint U.S.-Korea Academic Studies book, who has really been quite instrumental in putting that book together and helping to bring our panels together. If you're interested in the topic of sanctions on North Korea, we also invite you to join us for a Korea Club event next Wednesday with Joshua Stanton, who was instrumental in drafting the most recent round of sanctions in Congress. Further information can be found on our website. I'll now turn over things to our moderator today, Dr. Haggard.
Thanks very much, Don. Thanks very much, Don, for the introduction. I'm surprised to see so many people here, and it's a pleasure to be in Washington. I don't get out here as much as I'd like. So this project has an interesting gestation because it's part of the long-suffering effort to figure out how we might engage North Korea. But then while the project was in train, you had the fourth nuclear test, the satellite launch, and the whole context in which the papers emerged fundamentally changed. So in some ways, we were thinking about engagement, and now we're thinking about engagement in the context of UN Security Council Resolution 2270, the US sanctions legislation, and the executive order that was released last week, and whether those measures will in fact be implemented and how, and on what type of time schedule. The other thing I'd just like to note about the context of all of this is it's unfolding against a very important political backdrop in North Korea itself, which I don't think gets adequate attention, which is the convening of the first party Congress since 1980. So it's been a substantial lag between the time that the party is convened in a non-ad hoc way. It met at two times during the succession, but to actually convene a party Congress, it's clear that important things are going to happen in Pyongyang sometime in May. So all of this is taking place under that shadow. So the purpose of these papers is basically to look at economic engagement and sanctions between four of the five major parties that are participants in the now defunct six-party talks. And I'll just introduce the participants very briefly. There'll be short 10-minute presentations, and then I'll moderate a brief discussion among us, but we'd really like to get to the floor. And we'll start with Troy Stangerone, who is here at the KEI. He's the editor of the flagship publication here, handles podcasts, and has worked for a long time on the Hill with respect to legislative issues. He'll be talking about South Korea. Dr. Li Yingting has a degree in history, a PhD in history from the University of Chicago, and has visited at Yonsei and the Asan Institute, and now teaches in the Department of Korean Studies at Peking University. She'll be talking about China. Lyudmila Zakharova is a senior researcher at the Russian Academy of Sciences Institute of Far Eastern Studies, and particularly their Korea division, where she also received her PhD, my understanding is correct. And finally, Bill Brown, who's currently an adjunct at Georgetown, but has long experience working on these issues at commerce and on the international economy more generally, will talk a little bit about the U.S. perspective. So we'll start with you, Troy. Thanks.
Thank you. Good afternoon, and thank you, Dr. Haggart. So, if you'll give me just a second, it's not coming up. Oh. All right. So, when we think of it now in terms of South Korea, we're in a unique situation, and South Korea was always unique in relation to North Korea to begin with, to where the question becomes sort of, what type of economic relationship, if any, is viable? And if we look back, all right, so inter-Korean trade. If we go back, now, this goes back further, but I wanted to make this somewhat manageable, and look from 2006 up through last year. In essence, what we can see is you had about $1 billion in trade, a little over in 2006. You see it kind of caps off in the 2007 through 2010 period. You hit 2011, you have a drop. Then you see 2013, there's a significant drop. That's when the North Koreans withdrew from Kaesong for about 6 months. Then it picks back up and we're up to about $2.5 billion. The other interesting thing to think about this is that over time, we've seen a narrowing of scope in terms of trade between North and South Korea. Originally, trade between the two were processing trade. You had tourism in Mount Kumgang and other types of things going on. But when you hit 2010, you have the sinking of the Chonan and the May 24th sanctions. And after that point, Mount Kumgang had already been essentially shut down due to the death of a South Korean tourist there. All other investment and economic interaction with North Korea was essentially cut off. Kaesong was allowed to remain, but even Kaesong had restrictions. There was supposed to be no new investment, so there were different companies who had applied to take and build factories. They were prohibited from doing so. So in essence, while you saw an increase in production over time at Kaesong, even it was essentially static. So now, if we also think about this in terms of context of, you know, what types of things could South Korea do with North Korea? Well, there's a series of different things that have either been done or proposed. As I mentioned, and I've got at the bottom, we had processing trade take place. Under the Park Geun-hye administration, and even if you go back to the second summit with Nomu Yun, you had discussions of building additional industrial complexes similar to Kaesong and other parts of North Korea. We had the Mount Kumgang tours. There's always been discussion for a long time of reconnecting the rail line so that way South Korea could take and ship goods across North Korea all the way into Europe. The advantage of that historically would have been at lower cost. Today, given the low cost, if any of you follow the Baltic Dry Shipping Index, shipping costs are essentially dirt cheap. Now the primary benefit of that would largely be time in terms of that it can get there a few weeks quicker into European markets. So for things like clothing, where you have quick turnover in terms of fashion and things, it would be very beneficial. Discussion of sending Russian gas across North Korea via a pipeline to South Korea. You also had recently the Rajin Kasan project, which would take and allow the shipping of Russian coal through the Rajin port into South Korea. There's some time to time a discussion of South Korea actually going and doing joint mining operations with the North Koreans as well. So there's a series of different types of economic engagement projects that have either been proposed. Some of them, like the pipeline, others have gotten to sort of the beginning of fruition, but then sort of essentially cut off due to politics or other reasons. But this has sort of been historically the kind of gamut of projects you will, if you will. So now, after the nuclear test and the missile launch or the satellite launch, we have a series of sanctions in place. There's been a lot of discussion of the UN sanctions, the cargo inspections, which are now mandatory, the limitations on the natural resource exports, anything that is believed to take and contribute to the nuclear program, though you do have this livelihood exception in place, the limitations on aviation fuel exports, the complete arms sales ban now. You have the beginning of a formalized luxury goods list that all countries have to respond to. In essence, though, I would say if you think about the types of things South Korea was doing with North Korea and the types of things it might do, to an extent, these don't really apply. And what really matters in the case of North-South Korea relations are the South Korean measures. So, as I mentioned, we had the May 24 sanctions, which had already very severely restricted interaction between the two. You've had now the closure of Kaesong. South Korea and its own bilateral sanctions on North Korea took and implemented a ban on any ship entering a South Korean port that has been to North Korea in the last 180 days. Practically speaking, this in essence took and led to the take and the suspension of the Rajin Kasan project, and so you have that. So if you look at North-South Korea economic interaction today, it is zero. And if you look at the chart I gave you, 2016 will have a very small amount because you had a little bit of things going on at Kaesong before it was shut down. But on the course we're on right now, next year it would be a zero. So the question sort of becomes, and I think as we look going forward, you know, what types of potential futures do we have with North Korea? And what types of options might we have going forward if the political circumstances change to allow things to take place? Now, when we think about it in this sort of way, I think we also need to look back at prior South Korean engagement with North Korea and try to discern what worked, what perhaps didn't work, and why. And so when we go through and we look at the Sunshine Policy, which was the name under Kim Dae-jung, or economic engagement with North Korea, more generally speaking, I think there's some things that we need to consider. So if we take sort of the general conceptual idea of the Sunshine Policy, and this is, you know, Kim Dae-jung took and put it forward sort of in the idea of Aesop's fable of the north wind and the sun. And the idea being is that if you apply, you know, pressure like the north wind, wind, hail, rain, that it only takes and it makes the person put their coat on much, much more tightly. But if you gradually warm them over time, the heat will take and have them remove their coat, and you can take and begin to engage with them. Now, there's always a challenge. One of the books that I remember reading that I found very interesting, I don't know if you've had a chance, but if you haven't, you should, it's called Analogies of War, and it talks about how we tend to think in these analytical or angelistic terms, but that they can often be misconstrued or not actually apply to what we'd like to apply them to. And, you know, there's always the potential, and I think of the Sunshine policy case for that as well. And so if we think about the Sunshine policy, which was largely an idea of trying to take and use engagement with North Korea to create coexistence and then prosperity over time and eventually lead to unification, what have we actually seen happen, or what have been some of the real challenges? Well, you know, depending on who you talk to, you'll get a series of different, perhaps, challenges that Sunshine and engagement faced. And if you look at somebody like Moon Chung-in, who wrote a book on the Sunshine policy, he would argue that essentially it never really had a chance, maybe only 6 months to a year and a half, to where it was actually a viable policy that was engaged. But, you know, one of the reasons he lists and that others would talk about is divergent policy with the United States. When Kim Dae-jung came to power, the Clinton administration had sort of, you know, accepted and supported this idea, but the Bush administration came in with much different ideas and shifted to a much harder line policy. And so you had a divergence of policy between the United States and South Korea, and that it was difficult for the Sunshine policy to work when the United States, South Korea's primary security partner, was on a different page. I tend to look at this from a slightly different perspective, and, you know, I've put up here democratic sustainability, but in essence what I mean is that if we look at the Sunshine policy, it was essentially conceived under the idea of long-term change within North Korea. And the challenge within democratic societies is that long-term policies are very difficult to sustain. You have democratic elections where new leaders come to power, new leaders have new policies, circumstances intervene. And if you look at things like the Sunshine policy, the idea of long-term benefits but short-term gains are very difficult within democratic societies to accept. So as North Korea engages in provocations, the policy loses support, and there's a desire to take and push for a different type of policy. And what that means is that even if Sunshine would work, it's very difficult to sustain under the long term in a democratic society. So you have this challenge. You have the inability to separate the political and the economic. One of the goals of the policy, or the stated effects visually, was to separate out the economic from the political, so that way you could try to engage on this one level, knowing that the North Koreans were not going to, on a political level, necessarily change quickly. But every time you have a different provocation or something, all of that ties back into the political side of things, making it more difficult, as we've seen in Kaesong and other projects, to take and move forward on the economic front. Limited intercultural exchange. One of the things that I think is interesting, and we often talk about the idea of North Korea being similar to East Germany, but there are significant differences. And one of them is that if you look back historically, the Soviet Union had significantly more influence over East German policy than Beijing has ever had over Pyongyang. And it was actually the Soviet Union that pushed East Berlin to essentially take and begin engaging with West Germany to allow West Germans to come to visit their relatives and vice versa. So you have the situation where there's been, even though the Sunshine Policy called for there to be more intercultural exchange, very little of it done. And that means the two societies have never really had a chance to take and essentially loosen tensions and get to know each other better and lose some of the preconceptions they had. You have a problem between political risk and private risk. If we look at Kaesong and a lot of the other projects, over time, they all became essentially government-supported, government insurance. And so rather than firms investing within North Korea based on market conditions that would be profitable for them, they invested based on these government guarantees. And what the government guarantees meant then at the same time, though, is that it reduced the incentive for North Korea to make reforms because they knew there was a certain guaranteed amount of investment that would come their way because the South Korean government was going to promote it that way. So you have this division between the political and the private risk. Limited economic transformation. If you look at the idea behind Kaesong, the idea of taking and utilizing South Korean know-how and capital to combine it with North Korean labor and to provide basically a area to take and teach the North Koreans how to take and, you know, do production, how to take and engage the international community, how to learn the marketing and the production skills you need to take and reform the economy, it ultimately ended up having limited impacts. You had very few backwards linkages into the North Korean economy, though there were some items that were purchased, like foodstuffs for Kaesong from North Korea. You also then had this problem to where, because of that, it didn't actually spread out within to broader reform within North Korea. And so you have this sort of limited transformation that took place. And you know, I've talked briefly about the idea of the limitations of analogies, but I think, you know, to try and bring in a slightly different fable and say, you know, if we're going to take and engage North Korea, one of the things to consider is, you know, also the fable or the story of the emperor's new clothes. As we all know, the idea is that the emperor has these new fancy outfits that are designed, but they're not really clothing. There's nothing there. And so to sort of, if you will, mix metaphors, you know, I think one of the challenges we face with North Korea is that what if in trying to take and, you know, be the sunshine and engage the North and to get them to remove their coat, if North Korea is self-conscious and that North Korea really is the emperor who has no clothes on underneath, but knows that. And so if you know that you are devoid underneath, you will still cling to that coat no matter what, even if the sun warms you up. So I think, you know, we need to sort of think through these types of challenges going forward. So what are the potential futures now that we have the sanction regime in place and that essentially all relations between North and South have been cut off? Well, I think you can basically wrap everything up into about five potential futures. One is that we enter a situation of long-term sanctions to where the countries in the region maintain sanctions, they enforce them going forward, and this stays in place for a long time as North Korea is unwilling to take and change its policies. Another option, the option that I think all the governments are hoping for, is that you eventually move into a situation where negotiations begin and you find a negotiated solution to the problem. The third option, which ties into the first, is sanctions leakage. As we may all remember in the case of Iraq, the longer sanctions are in place over time, different actors tend to take and view the enforcement of sanctions as no longer being in their interest. And so while they may nominally enforce them, enforcement over time lapses and you have goods smuggled in and other types of things taking place. There's also the option that there could be a policy shift that we don't foresee in one of the countries or South Korea. If we all remember, as I said, you know, the George W. Bush administration came to power with a very hardline policy towards North Korea. By the second administration, they had shifted policy and moved to one of negotiations. So we could, at some point, either in a future election or for some other reason, due to a political situation developed, see a policy shift take place. Or, and I think this is the least likely option, you could see the end of the regime. But those are probably the options that we have going forward in terms of how things may play out. So with that in mind, and I want to emphasize up front, I am not saying that we should economically engage with North Korea at the current time. It would be inappropriate. But given that there are potential futures to where economic engagement may come back into the policy prescriptions of policymakers, I think we need to think through what types of things and, in essence, under what conditions we would be willing to take and economically engage with North Korea. Having looked at the challenges from Kaesong, having dealt with the concerns of whether the money there is being utilized to fund the nuclear weapons and missile programs or not, and having sort of uncertainty of whether the money that was supposedly being taxed by the North Koreans was actually going to the purposes where it was supposed to, here are some things I think we should be thinking about. They may not all ultimately be easy to implement. They may not be necessarily things that could be done right away. But this is the kind of contract I think we should be thinking about if things do change at some point. Governmental reforms we'd like to see. A national tax system. This is actually something that potentially the North Koreans are already considering. There's discussion that at the Party Congress coming up, Kim Jong-un may announce some type of new national tax system. But I think this would make it easier in terms of understanding North Korea's revenues, in terms of businesses being able to engage, knowing what the structure of the system is. National budgeting and accounting. One of the challenges we have is that we don't know where anything is going. The North Koreans probably, to be honest, don't really know where everything is going. And, you know, if you all remember when China set up the AIIB, one of the reasons that they declined North Korea's interest was that, in essence, there are no national accounts. And so I think this is a reform that we should be taking and pushing the North Koreans to do. Ultimately, you know, accounts can be fudged and things. There's always, you know, caveats, but I think this would be a positive step in the right direction. Open markets for sales and purchase. If Kaesong at some point were to reopen, I think there needs to be the ability to take and buy more inputs from North Korea and also to take and sell the products in North Korea as well. You know, you really want to spread the market reforms, you actually have to allow Kaesong to spread out beyond where it is right now. Investment structure. I think we need to, as I said, shift essentially from a government-led structure to a market-led structure. If there are good market business reasons and if the sanctions either change or not an issue, then you take and let companies make those decisions based on that rather than simply government subsidies and government insurance. That being said, I'm not so naive as to think that companies would be interested in investing in North Korea, given the problems you've had with Orascom, with others as well. I think one of the things that if you get to a point of economic engagement, you should have is essentially a self-funded form of insurance. So what I would propose is that out of the tax structure the North Koreans put in place, certain amounts of the taxes on companies would go into a separate fund not managed by the North Koreans to provide insurance in the situation to where the political situation or something else changes. Labor market reforms. Practically speaking, and this some of this goes back to when I was working on how you internationalize the Kaesong Industrial Complex sort of after the 2013 crisis, we have to move to direct payment of workers. You know, it's the best way to take and put in place a tax system in North Korea. It's the best way to know that the workers are getting the money they're supposed to get. It's also the best way to make sure that you can minimize as much as what might be potentially funneled into other accounts in North Korea. So you need to pay the workers directly. And as a side note, I have the guidelines for the Kaesong Industrial Complex, and this was always supposed to be the way it was supposed to be done. The North Koreans just never allowed it. So we need to take and move beyond simply reaching an agreement, but actually making sure that things are done the way we want it to be done or agree to do it. You know, salaries need to be set by the market. You know, no more 5% annual raise every year just because, you know, it's the year and we're going up. If it makes sense to raise wages because production and efficiency is up, then you do. If it's not, you don't. If you have a good worker who you want to take and make sure doesn't defect to another company, you can raise their wage. If they're not good workers, you could take, and you need to be able to hire and fire them on your own as well. So no more state enterprises essentially providing the workers to you. So also, you need logistical and infrastructure reform. Once again, the internet and cell phone issues had always been, or were always supposed to be allowed at Kaesong. You know, we need to make sure that, you know, businesses have the tools they need to work within North Korea. Customs procedures need to be eased. This was always one of the nagging issues at Kaesong. And I think the North Koreans need a little more skin in the game, too. You know, in terms of the infrastructure, they need to be taking and investing some of the revenue they're gaining from the production into the infrastructure that would be needed. But there's a few other approaches I think we should consider as well, beyond sort of these kind of very sort of process-oriented, almost, if you will. One, we need a balanced approach to the humanitarian side. I was at a conference, and I'm not a doctor, but I was talking to some experts on TB, about like how TB works and the efforts that people are doing to take and address TB in North Korea. If you have someone who is a member of the elite and they have tuberculosis, they are just as likely to spread it to someone who is not a member of the elite and to the rest of the population, and it's a highly contagious disease. So we need to take and ensure that we're taking and trying to address the TB crisis that exists in North Korea as well. And that's something that I think we should view at separately. But at the same time, you know, in the past, if you remember, there's often large amounts of fertilizer and food aid given to North Korea. That's not always been productive, and you've actually seen, as some of that's been cut off, production in North Korea increase. So we need to think about the humanitarian side of things in a very practical way. What are the types of things that would actually help the populace, and what are the things that might actually hinder the changes we need to see to take and get North Korea to both economically reform and to help build a better sustainable society? Enhanced environmental protections. In essence, we need to take, and for the mines and other things, ensure that you have proper environmental rules. There's a large environmental crisis in North Korea as well. I think this is probably the most unrealistic idea I have, but dedicated reinvestment, the idea that some of the funds the North Koreans get from companies actually go into other positive things, be it reforestation or other things of the like. I think we need to think through how we do engagement in the sense of that some projects make sense much further in the future when you've had the proper types of reforms as opposed to those that might make more sense at a different stage. And lastly, I think we should think small. Small-scale wind and solar in areas to where you're just in the rural poor, people who are not the elite, but who we can maybe help have a better life. So as I said, I'm not saying that now is the appropriate time to engage, but I do think we need to think about how we would engage if that situation were to change. Thank you very much.
Hello, everyone. Yeah, I'm very glad to be here presenting this paper. But firstly, I want to explain that I just arrived yesterday, so I'm a little jet-lagged, and I don't usually use English as my working language in Beijing. So please feel free to stop me if I'm not clear on anything. But I'll try to present the paper in the sense that everyone could understand it. And as Professor Haggard just mentioned, this project was actually conceived last December, so that's before North Korea conducted the fourth nuclear test. So the paper initially was designed to study how the most recent situation of North Korea's economic relations is. And so as a result, it's a little focused on just China-North Korea trade. But I'll try to present the paper in the sense that I'll focus on the findings that are related to the most recent sanction regime. And I'll be open to discussions in the sense that, I'll be open to discussions later. So here is, firstly, the general trend of China-North Korea trade in 2015. I think it's declining in a very obvious sense. I'm going to talk about it in two senses. First is trade of goods. That is the data on this paper, on this slide. So I broke it down to the volume of trade and the balance of trade. So if you look at the volume of trade, the decline is quite obvious in 2014 and especially in 2015. If you look at the right downside of it, it declined from 4,545 to 6,363 million dollars. And well, you have the numbers there. So, it's quite obvious. It's a large decrease if you think about it, in the sense that it's almost 1/6 of the total volume of trade. And here I want to emphasize that usually we get the sense that China is the largest trade partner of North Korea, and it covers like 80% or 90% of North Korea's international trade volume. But that is the data excluding the inter-Korean trade, that is between South Korea and North Korea, because it is not considered international trade in the South Korean sense. If you include that in the total volume of North Korean trade, the actual percentage of China's is much smaller than people would think. So it's about 63% or 64% in 2014, and maybe about 55% in 2015, but the total number is not out yet. And then the balance of trade. Actually, China has always been recording a trade surplus to North Korea, and it's declining in the most recent years. So it was, you have the numbers there, it was $721 million US dollars in 2013, but it declined to 680 some, and then 380 in 2015. Well, this is, I guess, a lot of people have noticed this, but if you think about it in the net income, in the sense of net income of North Korea, everybody is thinking that China is the largest trade partner of North Korea, and so that is making China the biggest target. If you think about like a sanctioning on North Korea, but actually, if you think about the balance of trade, China is always recording surplus, and actually North Korea is not earning net income from trading with China, and it has to use actually trade surplus with South Korea to fund or to finance the trade deficit with China. And this is, I'm not saying this is making China not important and China not the most important trade partner of North Korea's, but I'm trying to emphasize that this might be interesting, or this might be relevant to think about when we think about sanctioning on North Korea, and when we think about how important or how much role China can play. The next one is trade service, but I don't have as good data on trade service because it's a more loose kind of term. So here I have two tables. One is on North Korean visitors to China. This is not really directly related to service trade, but people these days are emphasizing North Korea's export of labor to China and to Russia and to other countries. Well, this number is not very clean because you don't have clean data on North Korea's labor export to China. But we have one category that is titled working and crew. That is the second one from the last. That might include the export of labor to China. But it's not declining, but it's not increasing significantly either in the most recent years. We are not exactly sure what these numbers mean, because they might include repeated counts of the same person entering into China for a couple of times. And some of these people might be working in China, in Chinese factories. Some of them might be working in North Korean restaurants, and some of them might be just on short missions. So we're not clear what these numbers are. But it is significantly larger than what we think of when we talk about North Korean export of labor, because according to recent statistics, there are about 20,000 North Korean laborers in China as of 2013, and I guess the number is almost the same in 2015. Anyway, it's not increasing, but it's not declining very significantly either. But if we look at the Chinese side, that is the Chinese export of service to North Korea, which not a lot of people are noticing, it is declining very significantly in at least 2014, because we don't have the 2015 number. China is exporting service to North Korea in the sense that a lot of Chinese companies are working as contractors of construction projects in North Korea, and that is the largest or the majority part of Chinese service export. So you can see the number there. It's also peaked in 2013, but fell by about a quarter in 2014. And the official statistics is not out yet, but in 2015, it's at least not increasing. And a lot of people are saying that it must be smaller than that of 2014, although we have to wait for the official number. So it was declining, at least in 2014, and starting from 2014 and declining in a significant way in 2015. So why was the China-North Korean trade declining? Here, we can have a lot of reasons for that or explanations for that, but I try to identify two of them in order to make it simple and clear. So here I identified two reasons. One is the decline of North Korean mineral exports, and the other is the suspension of cooperation platforms after Chang Sung-taek's execution. So you can think of the first one as a little bit more economic causes, and the second one a little bit more political, if you like. The decline of North Korean mineral exports have been emphasized by a lot of scholars, and I don't want to use too much time on that, but you can see the numbers there. And the biggest export item of North Korea to China is coal or anthracite. You can see there is a large decline, and it used to cover over 40% of North Korea's export to China, but these days at least in 2015, it fell below 40%. And then iron ore is another major export item of North Korea to China. It used to be the second largest export item, at least until 2013, but it fell more significantly compared to coal. And you can see that it's almost like one-fourth or one-fifth in 2015 compared to 2013. And now these days, in 2015, it ranked number 6 in North Korea's export item to China. It used to be number 2. So you can see it's very significant decline. And then the second reason, or the political cause of that, is everybody knows about the difficult political relations between North Korea and China. I'm not saying it is as important as the first one in explaining the decline of China-North Korea trade, but I'm saying that at least it's not helping reversing the declining trend, and it's, on the contrary, it's even making it worse. There are several new platforms, cooperation platforms, established between North Korea and China in 2010, and the most important one, there were four most important ones, but two of them were closed down after Chang Sung-taek's execution in December 2013. So starting from 2014, that is when we begin to see the decline of China-North Korea trade, two of them were closed down. One is suspended. One is the North Korea Investment Office in Beijing, and the other is the Huang Jinping and Weihua Islands economic regions, located just next to Dandong City. I don't have time to elaborate on that, but if you're interested, you can refer to the paper later, and there is more explanation about that. What I'm trying to say is that the suspension of these platforms are important, not in the sense that they hurt the actual number or the actual volume of trade between China and North Korea, but it hurt people's expectations that the cooperation is growing or is gonna be better or stuff. So it hurts the most sense in the sense of expectation. And then a lot of people noticed that China began to build a lot of infrastructures in the Northeast Asian, Northeast provinces, Northeastern provinces, or the China-North Korea border. And I'd like to say that these opened some new possibilities for China-North Korea trade in year 2015, but unfortunately, these new possibilities were closed down due to the North Korea fourth nuclear test. These infrastructures include some border economic zones, actually two of them, and then one shipping route, according to media reports. And then there was some renovation work of ports of entry being conducted or being planned. These constructions were made because of China's Belt and Road Initiative. I'm sure everybody has heard about it. But I want to emphasize here that North Korea is not an official partner of this initiative. But nonetheless, China is not excluding North Korea from this initiative because of the low growth rate of the northeastern provinces, and because the border facilities between China and North Korea are really old. Many of them were built under the Japanese rule, and it's not fair to just exclude everything just because the relationship between China and North Korea is not great. So anyway, and they're not being put to use, at least in the foreseeable future, because of the current situation. Then I want to talk about some of the effects of further downturn of China-North Korea trade. These predictions were made without prediction of a North Korean nuclear test, but under the current sanctions regime, the downturn should be larger than originally. So anyway, we can get some hints of the possible effects from the recent data, that is data of 2014 or 2015, after the volume of China-North Korea trade began to decline. So the sense is we get some hints of the future effects from the past experience from the period that the China-Korea trade had already begun to decline. Again, it's you can get more details from the paper, but here I get three most important things that I want to emphasize. The first one is while the volume of China-North Korea trade declined, the deficit of North Korea's, that is North Korean deficit to China, also declined. As you can see here, it declined from about $700 million to $380 million. And there were many possible explanations for that. But anyway, North Korea managed to decrease its import from China to a larger extent than the decrease of its export to China. That means it is sensitive to China-Korea economic relations, but it might not be so vulnerable to the decline of that, because it somehow managed to decrease the import to a larger extent. That is because North Korea had some control, some degree of control, or some degree of elasticity on import. And everybody knows that if the state has a stronger control over the trade relations, then it might have more influence on the decrease of import. Anyway, it's sensitive to China-North Korea relations, but might not be so vulnerable. And the second one is that North Korea managed to export more ready-made garments, that is, clothes like men's overcoats, men's suits, and women's overcoats and women's suits to China in order to make up for the decrease of mineral exports. So in 2013, it used to be $429 million, and then in the next 2 years, it's somewhere about $515 million. There were many ways to explain this or to read this, but this points to a possibility that North Korea might be attempting a new round of trade restructuring. In the past, it used to successfully restructure its trade structure, especially after the May 24th measures, that is the unilateral sanctions placed by the South Korean government. Before that, South Korea was a very important trade partner of North Korea and the largest source of trade surplus of North Korea. And then China was not so significant in the North Korea's international trade relations. And then China had a greater trade surplus to North Korea, most of which was financed by North Korea's trade surplus to South Korea. But after the May 24th measurement, North Korea's trade surplus decreased, so it had to find new sources to finance its trade deficit to China. And then it enlarged its export of minerals to China, in the sense that we saw the numbers there. There were coal and iron ores and stuff. And as a result, North Korea was able to finance or to enlarge its trade relationship with China because of the income of exporting those minerals. So this time it might be attempting another round of trade restructuring by enlarging the export of labor-intensive products. Well, it might be successful, or it might be not. but at least it should be more difficult than the first round of trade restructuring because it engages, it will involve more cooperation with international partners in the sense that it needs investment and cooperation and logistics and everything. So, yeah. Anyway, we cannot rule out the possibility of that. And then the last one is while North Korea's export to China decreased, its import to China decreased to a larger extent. And then most of, actually each and every one of its major import items to China decreased to a large extent. It's not very clear what that points to us, but and I don't have a chart or table here, but I think the largest one is something filament fabrics, and then freighter cars and telephones and petroleum oils and something. And each and every one of them fell by over 20% during the last 2 years. And then these are the top five import items from China. And then some important things are North Korea's import of rice and maize, that is the main grains from China, dropped by over 70% in the last 2 years. That is something might arouse concerns because again, there are many ways to interpret that. But one way to interpret that is North Korea cut its import of grains to a larger extent than the other materials for industrial production or stuff. So this might be interesting, or this might be worth to explore when we think about the humanitarian effects if we make tougher sanctions on North Korea. And then finally, the last page is about things after the international sanction. There were many implications, but most importantly, I want to point to the two relevant sanction provisions. That is the mandatory cargo inspection and conditional prohibition of North Korean coal and iron ore exports, which is mostly which is closely related to what we were talking about here, that is China-North Korea trade. And then, again, the Chinese government's standpoint is it supports the full and comprehensive implementation. The meaning of that we might discuss later. And then there were three implications that we can get from the main findings of this paper. One is that it might be important to think about the trade of volume versus vis-a-vis the balance of trade in terms of thinking of what China's role could be in the sanctioning of North Korea. And the second one is the effectiveness. Even if China implemented the sanctions very strictly, and even if we succeeded in further decreasing the China-North Korea trade, as we explained earlier, it might not be so effective in changing the North Korean policies because, as we said earlier, North Korea was sensitive to the decline of China-North Korea trade, but it might not be so vulnerable as we imagine in the sense that it might not change its policies so quickly, even if it hurts a lot, and even if it doesn't it cannot find effective ways to enlarge China-North Korea trade or North Korea's international trade. So that is something we need to think about in terms of formulating new policies. And the last one is humanitarian concerns. When we think about North Korea will have to decrease its import from the international world, and when we think about how limited its capability is in providing all the kinds of necessities for its people, there might be humanitarian concerns coming after the new sanction regime. Well, thank you.
Hello, everyone. Very happy to be here and give my presentation. Thank you very much. No. Stay here. Okay. So My idea is to give you some kind of overall understanding of what is going on in economic sphere between Russia and North Korea. I also have very limited time, so I just try to touch on the main points, and you can ask me if you're particularly interested in anything in detail. So, first of all, I would like to tell you what the current Russian policy toward North Korea is. In comparison with the Soviet times, the current Russian policy is perceived as being very pragmatic. And according to the latest foreign strategy, foreign policy strategy of the Russian Federation, Russia aims to maintain friendly relations with both the DPRK and the Republic of Korea based on the principles of mutually beneficial cooperation. And ideally, Russia would like to use this trilateral relations to develop its Far Eastern regions. At the same time, Russia supported and fulfills all the United Nations Security Council resolutions imposing sanctions against North Korea. But Russian government position is that we don't want to isolate North Korea, it's counterproductive, and isolating North Korea wouldn't help to solve the problem. And Russian government tries to make effort to achieve denuclearization on the peninsula through dialogue and negotiations, and to continue economic exchanges with North Korea in areas not restricted by the sanctions and not connected with the military programs. In the recent years, when I speak about recent years, I mean mainly 2014, 2015, and we'll see what happens this year. But there have been several measures that can tell us about Russia's interest to develop an economic ties with North Korea. First of all, the final settlement of $11 billion debt of North Korea became a clear evidence of Russia's interest to further develop an economic ties with North Korea, as for many years, this problem, the debt problem, was cited as one of the main obstacles preventing bilateral economic relations from further growing. I don't think it was the only obstacle, but it was often cited as one of the main obstacles. Although Russia has very important security considerations, as it shares a border with North Korea and is very much interested in stability on its eastern frontier, and security is really important for us, but at the same time, Russia has very important economic goals, the achievement of which could be facilitated through cooperation with North Korea. And in 2012, the Russian government got a new addition in the face of Far East Development Ministry, and now it's the main power pressing to develop economic ties with North Korea. The Far East Development Minister heads the Russian part of Intergovernmental Commission on Trade, Economic, Scientific and Technical Cooperation between Russia and North Korea. These meetings had a long break, like 3-year break after 2011, but since 2014, the meetings resumed, and there have been regular meetings every year. And this commission is the main board responsible for growing bilateral economic relations. Also, since 2014, there have been an active exchange of high-ranking delegations promoting economic cooperation between two countries. And 2015 was even declared the year of friendship between Russia and North Korea. I would like to cover the issue of. Sorry. Doesn't listen. Please. Oh, good. So, first of all, I would like to tell you a bit about the trade between Russia and North Korea. After our respected Chinese participant told us about huge, in comparison with Russian volume, huge trade volume between China and North Korea, as you can see, Russia, it's $1 million. So, Russia is just a marginal trade partner for North Korea, but potential exists, I must say. But if you can see, as you can see from the table, trade volume wasn't really stable, and it had a trend to be reduced, unfortunately. But after the economic exchanges were revitalized. The authorities of the two countries kind of set a goal officially to grow bilateral trade, direct trade, by 2012 to $1 billion. And as you can see, it was about $100 million, so it's like tenfold growth. And in the trade between Russia and North Korea in 2014 further declined to, as you can see, $92.8 million. If you're interested in particular what was being traded between the two countries, you can see here the main import and export items. And maybe I have official statistics. To be honest, the statistics is a big problem in researching this subject, as Russia has really small trade volume with North Korea, and it's not really published often and regularly. So the statistics for 2015 probably exist, but it was not officially published yet. From what I heard from officials, they expected like a minor decrease even to this number. And the main items of trade were Russian oil and like mineral fuels and flour going from Russia to North Korea. And with, as you could see from the previous slide there, the bulk of the trade is presented by Russia's export to North Korea, and Russia's import from North Korea is insignificant. When the two countries declared a goal of growing bilateral trade, they knew that there were several problems to it. First one was the bank transactions. At the beginning of 2014, there were no North Korean bank accounts in Russian banks. So they had to work on it, and they signed an agreement on opening the bank accounts, North Korean bank accounts in Russian banks. And also they agreed to transit to ruble transactions. So the trade between Russia and North Korea is now conducted not in dollars, but in rubles. Also, another problem was the transportation, and still is, because Russia and North Korea, they share a border, but they have only single railroad bridge. There is no road bridge between two countries. So all the trade is conducted either by sea or by rail. But North Koreans have long been asking for a road bridge to be built. And now there are discussions of building a floating bridge between the two countries, which is also expected to help grow the bilateral trade. If we speak about investment and joint projects, I have listed several of them here, but the only large-scale project that Russia has implemented in North Korea is the already mentioned Hassan Rajin logistics project. It implied rebuilding of a 54-kilometer long railroad stretch from Russian station of Hassan, its border station, to North Korean port of Rajin, and building the freight in Rajin, building a freight terminal in Rajin for transshipments to Russian Trans-Siberian Railroad. It is, as the slide says, you can see it, the investment volume is estimated at about $250-300 million. It is operating now. This project is now it isn't operating at full capacity, because they expect to be handling about 5 million tons of cargo through Rajin every year, and the statistics of last year says us that there were 1.2 million tons of cargo, mostly coal from Russia to China, going through Rajin. And as already been mentioned here, a South Korean party was looking at joining the project. And there have been three test shipments of Russian coal to South Korea through North Korea, but unfortunately, at this unlucky timing after the nuclear tests, South Korea declined its withdrawal. There were several other projects, but despite the South Koreans' withdrawal, their project is going to keep running. There were some other projects, especially Victor project is very interesting, because it was based on the principle of extracting and selling North Korean minerals for in exchange for investment in the railroad and modernization, and also investing of this money in other projects of Russian companies in North Korea. Russian companies don't really have money to invest in North Korea. That's why they had to find some way to get the money from North Korea for this. But after the recent sanctions, this formula isn't going to work, obviously. There were some also agricultural projects in the Russian Far East, which North Koreans are very interested in. And also very important project for North Korea is electric power production and supplies. Right now, the most advanced project is to supply electric power from Russian territory to Rason economic zone. I don't really have time to speak more, unfortunately, but more detailed information is given in my paper. Another very important area of cooperation is labor migration. What I mean is that Russia is very much interested in recruiting North Korean labor for working in our Far Eastern regions. And as you can see from the statistics, the number of North Korean workers in Russia has been growing for 6 years. And actually, in 2015, North Korea was the third largest partner for Russia in this area of cooperation after China and Turkey. I think the number of Turkish workers is going to decline, so maybe North Korea will be the second one. Main areas where they work are construction, agriculture, forestry, healthcare, fisheries, textile and leather industries, as you can see. And this is actually a very profitable, but very mutually beneficial area of cooperation, which Russian companies are really interested in, as Russia has obvious lack of workforce in these Far Eastern regions. And North Korean workers are very interesting because they are very disciplined, they work a lot, and they are very well controlled by their own government, which is also good. Yes. And finishing my presentation, I would like to speak a bit about the prospects. It's a very tricky time to speak about what real prospects can be, because the sanctions were just imposed, and future will show us what happens next. But obviously, trilateral cooperation is suspended. For a long time, Russian policy toward North Korea was based on promoting these trilateral cooperation projects, and it was really important to engage both Koreas in Russian projects, which could be really very profitable for Russia. But right now, Russian government will have to realize that it's not going to happen in the near future. But as Russia is really interested in strengthening its positions on the eastern frontier, to my mind, Russia's policy of engaging North Korea economically will probably be continued. And as I said, there was an idea of using North Korean minerals, selling them for funding Russian projects in North Korea. The latest sanctions will probably have a negative impact on the prospects of bilateral economic cooperation. So they'll have to think of more creative ways to do business with North Korea. But the exchanges in unaffected areas, such as this Hasan Rajin logistics project that was exempted from the sanctions, as you could see from the resolution text, also such areas as maybe energy sector to a certain extent, like labor migration, yet. I know that some countries are trying to also do something with this area of cooperation, but right now it's not restricted. Also agriculture and maybe trade and other than restricted materials. This is likely to continue, I think. So that's my major point. If you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer. Thank you very much for your attention.
Yeah, in the interest of time, let me just read through my little, I have a little summary. I'll read that through and then breeze through my presentation real quickly. That way you can just cut me off if I start going too long. If I do my summary, then I feel happy, right? But I want to read it because I've done it fairly carefully. Maybe I'll move to the first slide, though. That kind of tells everything right there, right?
Much is made in Western circles of North Korea's economic dependence on China, amid questions of whether and how much leverage this gives Beijing. In an endgame, however, Pyongyang may think it has other cards to play, and Beijing, knowing this, leans toward caution. One important card long held by the North Koreans, and perhaps a trump card, is the relatively easy ways that Pyongyang could repair or at least improve relations with Japan, and from that gain great economic benefit. This may seem surprising and unlikely given the frosty, if not frozen, current relations. But it is this void in economic relations and the possibility that it could be filled quickly to the benefit of both sides that provides Pyongyang some room to maneuver should it run into real trouble. A few years ago, simply accepting a little more blame for the Japanese Koreans abducted two generations ago and providing more data on that ill-advised Kim Il-sung project might have led to normalization of political relations and tens of billions of dollars, in Japanese colonial-era reparations, enough to rebuild a great deal of the country's dilapidated infrastructure. The amount of money would certainly be large enough to give some credibility to Kim Jong-un's desire to build an economically prosperous country. But Tokyo's move to restore tough sanctions in mid-February, in the wake of the North Korean nuclear and missile test earlier this year, the tough new UN sanctions, and Pyongyang's immediate response of shutting down a promised internal investigation of the abductions makes chances of separating the abductions issue from the nuclear issue seem much more difficult. If so, Kim may have just lost his easiest path to the Japanese economy and to badly needed aid and investment. Still, after the dust is settled, one can imagine the young North Korean leader showing or even playing the abductee card, and thus tossing Japanese politics into a row by conceding just a few more points on the abductees. This, he could hope, would achieve a movement toward normalization and the big pot of reparation money, and perhaps blur the nuclear weapons issue that's so important to Washington. This, by extension, would throw Beijing, Seoul, and Washington all into policy confusion. Japan, after all, for the last 10 years, has been the most steadfast of countries in employing economic sanctions against Pyongyang. Moreover, a breakthrough on abductions is just the kind of surprise Kim would seem to like to employ. No doubt he understands that Japanese investigations could implicate his grandfather, but as economic and political pressures on his regime rise, it may be well worth watching Pyongyang-Tokyo maneuvering to see if there are signs of a deal, and if so, to carefully watch the Japanese. So that's my summary. Let me just quickly go through some slides. I want to talk a little bit about Japan-North Korea relations. From this chart here, you don't sort of get the relative importance, but back in the prehistory of here, Japan is hugely important to North Korea. Of course, in the colonial days, it's most important. Even during the Korean, not during the Korean War, but before and after it, Japanese relations with North Korea have always been much different than the rest of the West. It's always had kind of close, interesting relations. I think as late as probably by the 1990s, after the Soviet Union collapsed and China starts to reform, for a few years there, Japan is probably North Korea's number one economic partner. Maybe not quite in terms of volume, but one of the key points here is Japan is an was always an importer of North Korean goods, not just an exporter. Japan provides an environment, especially its million or so Koreans living in Japan, as a market for North Korean products. So as a market, Japan is incredibly important, or would be, should be, incredibly important to North Korea in a way that China and Russia really aren't. Of course, I think we know all the history. Japan built North Korea's manufacturing industry in the 20s and 30s. A lot of that stuff is still there. You look at the trains, you know, they look just like Japanese, old-fashioned Japanese trains. The equipment is all there. You can imagine Japanese companies just, oh, we would just so love to go in there and fix our old equipment up. Another point I like to make is it's a highly personalized relationship. Maybe a little bit like South Korea, but South Korea and North Korea have been, you know, frozen apart for a long time now. There's so many Japanese, there was such a Japanese involvement in Korea in the colonial era. A lot of those people all went back to Japan. But there's a funny little thing in the Japanese press I just saw it last night, this Japanese old guy who's just really into North Korean stuff. And he's collecting North Korean stuff. There's a lot of Japanese who just love to be interested in North Korea, just like here in Washington. There are a lot of people interested in North Korea, right? It's kind of that kind of notion. And on the Korean side, there's so many Koreans that went to Japan and have been treated fairly badly in Japan. They don't have passports, so they hook either to South Korea or North Korea, and a lot of them still retain relations with North Korea through their big organization. Their big organization, the Chosun Soran in Japan, is basically bankrupt. Most friendly people working with North Korea end up bankrupt, you know, because the North Koreans don't know how to do business or they cheat their friends. So this friendly group in Tokyo, in Japan, is basically bankrupt. But it still has several hundred thousand members, and they are linked to North Korea. So my point here is the relations here and through the abductions, it's a highly politicized, personal kind of relationship that we don't see with China, even South Korea, certainly not U.S. And Russia. The other point I like to make is they're so incredibly complementary. Japan is the richest country in this region, North Korea is the poorest country. That means there's a lot of gains from trade that can happen there. Think wages. My guess is, it's just a guess, but my guess is North Korean wages for doing the same thing is probably less than 10% of a Japanese wage. Think of the potential for mutual advantage for doing that. Japan has a lot of money, North Korea has none. Demographics, Japan is old, North Korea is still relatively young. North Korea has lots of minerals and metals, especially non-ferrous metals, that are hooked to steel making. And of course, Japan is still a big steel maker. That's why they developed North Korea in the first place, so going after the iron ore, but more importantly, the non-ferrous lead and zinc that are just sitting there waiting to be mined in North Korea. Rare earths, chemicals, go on and on. So it's this complementarity that's not being used that I'm thinking is just this huge potential. That's kind of a small chart, but shows you what North Korea exported to Japan in 1995. 2015, of course, it's zero, given Japanese sanctions, and what they've done with China. And I think there's no reason to think that if the sanctions weren't there, textiles, exports, fish, all these things, Japanese exports would maybe not equal China's, but they would be way up there. In other words, they would look back at 1995, before those sanctions, and just bring things up to the current, you'd see a lot more activity. Exports kind of the same way. Of course, the abductions thing has killed the economic relationship. The 2002-2004, there is kind of a sunshine policy that Prime Minister Koizumi tried to make a deal. They made some deal, but it broke down, and so turns out everybody gets mad. It's almost an emotional response. Japan froze relations. Had little to do with the nuclear issue. This is my other point. And another point, it's always been, as a North Korea watcher all of these years, watching this reparations issue, it's always been my big worry, tell you the truth, is that one day, Kim, Il-sung or Kim Jong-il or Kim Jong-un would wake up, hey, here's a pot of money. Why don't we do it? Let's just solve this not silly issue. It's a very important issue. But this, from a North Korean perspective, small issue of abductions. Why don't they do it and get this huge amount of reparations? But they never have. I've been thankful they haven't. Because I think if they got it, they would use it to rebuild their state, not to help the people. I'm not sure that Japan would actually do it, given North Korea's government. But Japan, from time to time, has hinted strongly that they owe, in effect, something like $10 billion to Japan, to North Korea. So why doesn't the North Koreans take that step? If you put these estimates down today's terms, it would be huge, really huge amounts of money. I'm thinking it's kind of a card game where, despite their need for hard currency, the North Korean leadership keeps cards in its hand, you know, just in case something really bad happens. And in this sense, in all of their relations with the West, with the rest of the world, they probably feel a little bit comfortable knowing they have these cards that they can play that they haven't yet played. That's true for all of our countries here, but I'm thinking with Japan, it's this abductions card. They don't want to play it because once they've played it, it's used, but they're holding it in case something, if they get in real trouble, they can play it. So I would argue, you know, when we're looking at North Korea, trying to analyze how they're going to deal with things, given Kim Jong-un is kind of an unknown quality, but he likes to make surprises, I could imagine him playing that card. Okay, that's about all I have to say here. We're looking forward to questions.
Oh, sorry. Okay, so we've been talking at you for some time. We were initially going to have a panel where I was going to moderate a discussion among us, but I'd like to turn more quickly to the floor. But before we do, I thought I'd just give you a few observations on my sense of the play of diplomacy that's happening now and is likely to happen over the next several months. Because we've been very much down in the weeds with what the trade relations are among the countries that make up the five parties. But that all is embedded in a strategic game that's going on, in my view, primarily between the United States, China, and North Korea. My view of South Korean diplomacy at this point is that President Park's National Assembly speech has sort of linked the nuclear issue to the fate of North-South relations in a way which is unusual for the past. And that therefore South Korean diplomacy is somewhat constrained to stay on a track of seeing progress in North-South relations very much contingent on what happens with respect to the nuclear front. So let me go through what I see the central issues being with respect to the three central players. And obviously Japan and Russia will have important roles going forward if the six-party talks are resumed. But currently, as both suggested, the leverage that they exercise is not central. So from the perspective of the United States, the key question is whether 2270 is actually going to be implemented. Because frankly, from the perspective of anyone who looks at this, I think objectively, if these sanctions were implemented in full, North Korea would experience substantial economic distress. And I'll explain exactly how that would unfold, but that's certainly something that the United States is going to be watching. Is whether there is evidence of material distress in North Korea, because there's no way you can read the sanctions resolution given its scope. And even if coal has dropped below 40%, you're talking about 35% of North Korea's income from trade basically being cut off in toto, in addition to caisson, in addition to the financial aspects of the sanctions resolution. So we'll be watching for material effect, but of course we'll also be watching for the question of whether North Korea shows any interest in negotiations, because part of the effects of the sanctions, the objective of the sanctions, is to start the six-party talk process. North Korea is not going to disarm unilaterally. No country disarms unilaterally. It's only going to occur through returning to a negotiation process of which the six-party talks are central. Now, the question for the United States, I think strategically, and it's a surprisingly difficult question, is that we now have an instrument in our pocket in the form of the sanctions legislation that was passed earlier in the year and the executive order which was released last week, which allows us to attempt to enforce 2270 from a distance. And if you look at the executive order closely, it's actually written in a quite clever way, because despite the inclusion of labor exports and a few issues surrounding human rights, which are of interest to people like Greg and me, most of the executive order actually says the following. The 2270 activities, if we see violations of them, we retain the discretion to exercise secondary sanctions against those firms. Now, my own view is that the decision of whether the United States is going to do that is both a technical one. We first have to know whether there are firms that we can designate that actually have exposure to the American financial system in such a way that they would be injured by that action. But the larger question, I think the much more difficult question, is does the United States want to pick the fight with China over North Korea? And that's not a trivial question. We've got plenty of things we're worried about with China beyond North Korea. And the Chinese have said very clearly that they're opposed to secondary sanctions that's been passed, and they're opposed to what's contained in the executive order. So turning to China, China's position with respect to North Korea has been exceedingly consistent. They've always stated that they are strongly in support of denuclearization on the peninsula. But I think from their perspective, the way that 2270 was reported was entirely on the sanctions side, but forgetting the fact that 2270 includes part of the parties to return to negotiation. And so China is now saying the bill on 2270 is due. We've done our bit. We've passed this sanctions resolution, which is clearly distinctive from prior sanctions resolutions. Is the United States going to engage in negotiations with North Korea or not? And this raises extremely crucial challenges of sequencing for the United States, because the United States' position with respect to the negotiation of a peace regime on the Korean Peninsula is in line with the 2005 joint statement that such negotiations would only begin after there was significant progress and perhaps even the completion of the core objectives of the six-party talks, namely the denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula, meaning the denuclearization of North Korea. And by the way, just an aside, the conception of denuclearization that was contained in the 2007 and 2008 when we were making progress, is not an Iranian-style deal. It's dismantlement of North Korea's capability, dismantlement of their capability, which tells you what a high hurdle this is going to be and how complicated these negotiations will be. But in the interim, China has started to float ideas about how the denuclearization and peace regime talks will be sequenced and integrated. And the United States is going to have to think hard about how it's going to respond to those proposals. Because it's anathema to the U.S. to sit down and have a peace regime negotiation with a nuclear North Korea. But on the other hand, is there some way that that issue can be finessed? And I think most people in the United States would say pretty hard to begin peace regime negotiations without progress on the nuclear front. But I guarantee you that China is going to be raising exactly this issue and making proposals about either an omnibus negotiation, parallel negotiations, something that would begin that process, and the United States is going to have a response to that. Finally, let me just say a few words on North Korea. I think the North we tend to think of the North Koreans as extraordinarily savvy simply because they survived. But I think we have to entertain the possibility that the leadership has actually erred quite significantly last period. First of all, I honestly don't see any reason why the Chinese would agree to 2270, which is this sweeping resolution, with no intention whatsoever of implementing it. I mean, it just makes no sense. And so even though I've been cynical in the past about the way that China has approached North Korea, they've actually been fairly straightforward. They've said in the resolutions that are passed that they have no interest in going after North Korea's commercial trade, and they haven't done so because they're not obligated to do so. That's not what the sanctions resolutions have said. So I think this signals something about what's going on in Beijing, and Professor Lee will obviously enlighten us more about that as we go forward. But if it's true that China is going to exercise some discretion in how 2270 is implemented, but nonetheless starts to implement it, I think it's possible that you could see a North Korea experience a financial crisis. Because, and the reason why is because the North Korean economy is more open than it's been before, and there are markets that operate that will be affected by a loss of income of that magnitude. And everyone's been needling me because they're saying, Steph, you claimed that something was going to happen on the exchange rate. It hasn't happened yet. The exchange rate is stable. Look, bear with it. This is not going to happen overnight. But if the sanctions are implemented, I would expect to see an extremely sharp depreciation of the yuan, which has a lot of material effects in North Korea. It's not going to be the sanctions directly that have effects. It's the fact that the yuan is going to tank, as the Iranian currency did, by the way. And that pain is distributed extremely widely in North Korea because individual households in North Korea rely on the market for the purchase of food. And those prices are affected by the yuan price of food, not the dollar price of food. Okay. So then the question becomes, what are we going to see in the run-up to the Party Congress? And again, I think that the Byungjin line, which those of you who don't follow North Korea, was rolled out in early 2013 and promised that North Korea would simultaneously pursue nuclear weapons and pursue economic development, something that most of us think is oxymoronic. But they don't think it's oxymoronic. They think it's possible to do this. Whether these anticipated effects will yield some signal that they are, in fact, willing to talk about the nuclear issue, which to date they have shown absolutely no interest in. And so if the United States has its dilemma, the dilemma for China is it's fine to tell the United States to go back to the six-party talks, but North Korea has no interest in going back. And so to a certain extent, the United States is saved the embarrassment of having to make this decision by the fact that North Korea has shown no interest. But on the website of the National Committee on North Korea, if you haven't seen it, there's a very interesting paper that the North Koreans have circulated about their conception of a peace regime. And those of us who watch North Korea for a living tend to look at little, small, granular things and maybe make too much out of them. But this paper has several interesting things in it. One is it makes absolutely no mention of the nuclear issue or a willingness to return to the nor to the 2005 joint statement, which is the minimum that the United States would have to see. But it does say something very interesting about the shape of peace. Namely, that South Korea, and I think this is the language, is not irrelevant to such a negotiation. And that China has a role in such negotiations, which means that the demand that the North Koreans have made that such peace regime negotiations would occur bilaterally with the United States, which frankly is a complete non-starter. The United States is not going to sit down and have peace regime negotiations. But they're leaving open the idea of a four-party negotiation. And if a four-party negotiation were to be proposed in a serious fashion, the United States would again have to figure out, would we do that if we could get the North Koreans to return to the talks, the six-party talks? And so I think that's the larger state of diplomatic play here. And I'll stop, but why don't we move to the floor because we've all said our bits and we can get people to respond to the outrageous ideas we put forward. So, yeah.
Mics are coming.
Thanks. Chris Nelson, Nelson Report. Thanks, Steph. Great summary. Professor Lee, if you think your English is poor, we're all humbled. That's all I can say. My God. and thank you. Yeah. Probably even grammatically perfect. Steph, you've nailed the key question that we've all been saying. We've got these sanctions in place now. Are they going to start to bite, and if so, how? Professor Zakharova and Professor Lee, both in a sense in, well, let me start that over. You guys know a lot about the domestic economy and situation in North Korea. From what you've seen and learned over the years, if we accept the premise that at least for the next few months, China and Russia are going to stick to the UN sanctions, again, from what you've seen, is it realistic to feel that the North Korean regime is going to really feel a sufficient squeeze to move on something? Or are we kidding ourselves that they simply adjust in some other way? I'm not asking for political judgment so much as what you know about how it works and how their money moves around and what the elites do. Is it realistic to think that that really vigorous enforcement by Russia and China especially is going to make a difference? Or are we just going to come back next fall and it'd be, you know, back in sort of the same endless circle that we've been stuck in for seems like 10 years now? So thank you. And Bill, thanks for that reminder on the abductees.
Professor, because do you want to make a comment on what you think the material effects of the sanctions might be if implemented?
Sure. Well, first of all, I think the Chinese government will certainly enforce the sanctions in a strict way, and if that goes on for a few months or longer than that, I'm sure that North Korea will suffer a lot from the decrease of hard currency income and then the import of Chinese goods. But I don't really think it's gonna feel the crisis or feel very difficult about its domestic material supply, because part of the reason is what I presented just now, because it has, based on the way how North Korea reacted during the most recent decrease of China-North Korea trade, it was quite successful in reacting to the decline or the decrease of hard currency income from China, in the sense that it sort of substituted imported goods from China with its domestic production somehow. We know that North Korea has been emphasizing on the North Korean style of management or economic management, and in the sense that it was emphasizing on increasing domestic production of consumer goods and stuff. I'm thinking if that was part of the reason why North Korea was able to reduce its import from China to such a large extent during the last year, when its income of hard currency from China reduced. And if that happens in the last year, I'm not totally, I'm pretty sure that North Korea will find some way to sustain it for the next few months.
I'll just make a very brief comment on this. I think that the differences between us are going to be very hard to adjudicate going forward, because my response is going to be that if we don't see distress, it's probably because China is exercising discretion with respect to the implementation of 2270. And if they're, and obviously you can see that China will say, no, we're going to implement these things in full. But we can come back to the issue of what the sanctions might do. I'll come back here. Yeah, please.
Hi, Andrew Yeo, Catholic University. I wanted to push you a little bit further, Professor Lee, on just the role, the effects that sanctions from China has, because when I looked at the comparisons with Russia and then with Japan 10 years ago, with Russia and Japan, you're dealing with hundreds of millions of dollars worth of trade, but with China, we're talking about billions. And so, I know you said that North Korea may be able to adapt based on the decrease in trade from in 2015, but I mean, these sanctions are quite significant. And so it sounds like you're trying to build a case to say that, you know, it's China doesn't hold the key. Look, that we've seen a decrease in trade. But I mean, I want to push you again. And when you look at your statistics in relative terms with other countries, it does seem like China holds significant clout. So if you could maybe say a few things on that issue.
Yeah, first of all, I'm not saying that China is not so important in terms of sanctioning on North Korea. What I'm trying to say is that even if China does, I think it will strictly enforce the sanctions terms, I'm not exactly sure whether North Korea will be so vulnerable to what China does based on the sanctions provision. That is what I'm trying to say. I'm not trying to say China is not influential or is not important to forcing North Korea. And then the second thing is that I think the impact of the sanctions is certainly a lot larger, a lot bigger than what we have witnessed in the year 2015. And in that sense, I agree with Professor Haggard to a certain extent, because in the past year, we have South Korea, especially the Kaesong district, from where North Korea was able to get a lot of trade surplus to finance everything else. But now, since the Kaesong industry area is closed down, and then North Korea's trade relationship with other countries, its other sources of trade surplus, including Ghana, India, and Bangladesh, actually they are quite important to North Korea's trade surplus. And I'm sure trade with the other countries will also be influenced. And in that sense, what North Korea will be suffering from in the next few months will certainly be much larger than in the past year. But again, I'm not sure whether that will be fatal to North Korea. That is what I'm trying to say.
You're in the front.
Yeah. Thank you. Mike Billington with Executive Intelligence Review. I wonder if our Chinese and Russian speakers can address what your governments have already addressed, which is the danger that this North Korean crisis is being used by the Obama administration and especially some of the war hawks who are committed to confrontation with Russia and China to in fact expand that confrontation. Stephen Haggard addressed the secondary sanctions. There's also the THAAD missiles, which even Park Geun-hye previously acknowledged were not useful against North Korea, but only against China and Russia. So I'd be very interested in your thoughts on that.
Lamilla, why don't you start?
I can start. Well, first of all, Russia is already under American sanctions, as you might know. So that's the question here is, to my mind, is that Russia is not that much engaged with North Korea right now. I tried to tell you that we were looking after more potential than just having something right now. And I can't say that Russian business is so much interested in North Korea. The government is doing as much as possible because under the current confrontation with Western countries and with the U.S. in particular, of course, Russia is interested in strengthening its positions anywhere, and in particular, Asia is also important. After this, of course, you know that Russia asked for a 24-hour period to review the resolution before it was passed. And I don't think that our government was particularly happy with the fact that China and the U.S. didn't really discuss the resolution with Russia. And as you know, Russia asked for some exclusions like Harajin Hassan logistics project and also some provisions about the aviation fuel. So Russia kind of feels a bit excluded from this process. And it's very much seen as, first of all, America-China confrontation right now. Of course, as you said, in the missile deployment in South Korea is not in the Russian interest at all, and we're trying to convey this idea to South Korean counterparts. But I think, from what I see, South Korea isn't
that much interested in Russia's position as in China's position. So I still think that the main confrontation line here and the main accent is on America-China confrontation here. So Russia has survived so many breaches of its security interests by Western countries in these recent years. So it's trying to strengthen its position. And right now, the discussions are going on how to do it in the case of North Korea. For our economic and security interests to be exposed as less as possible.
Thank you for the question. And what you mentioned is certainly one way among a lot of interpretations in China about what is going on between China and the U.S., especially in the earlier days, in the early days after North Korea conducted its nuclear tests and missile launches, and before North Korea and China could narrow their gaps about how the sanction resolution should be look like. That was just one scenario, and we think, well, I don't speak for the majority of Chinese experts or the Chinese government, but from the people I know, most of the people are saying that the confrontation in the initial period was to a large extent because of misunderstandings between the two countries, especially in terms of China's caution against putting rough sanctions on North Korea. But after China and the U.S. meet together and agreed on more terms about the sanctions, I think that part of misunderstanding was partly clarified, but certainly we have more work to do about that. And as you mentioned, and Professor Haggard mentioned about the secondary sanction that the U.S. is leaving to its discretion, that also has to do with the difference in the Chinese and U.S. understanding about this sanction resolution is about. From the Chinese perspective, this sanction, as stated in the resolution itself, this is not stated, but regime change is not the end of this sanction, and the sanction itself is not the end to the solution of the current situation in the Korean Peninsula. And the Chinese is thinking that since the resolution has mentioned, and also what you have mentioned about the return to dialogues and the pursuit of a peace regime, we think that also is part of the sanctions resolution. And since regime change is not the end or the purpose of this sanction, if the Chinese government sees the danger of regime change or some danger of the stability of the North Korean regime or government, I'm sure this difference of understanding about how sanctions should be enforced will rise again and might possibly bring back again the confrontational scenario between China and the U.S. But I think for now, it's not to that stage, it's not to that step yet, and we still have time to work on and to clarify this misunderstanding.
Just a couple sentences on that, because we really want to try to get some.
Yeah, just real quickly on that. I mean, prior to the current crisis, I mean, everything I had seen coming out of South Korea was very disciplined in that there had been no discussion. So I hadn't seen this comment. But that being said, if anyone has any questions on that and its utility in the current environment and what it would and wouldn't impact, Bruce Klingner has a very good paper where he drew it, and he shows very distinctively how it would significantly increase the ability to react to North Korean missile attacks and how very little of their time with the current missile defenses South Korea has. So that would just be something really quick on that you should look into.
Okay. Someone's holding the mic there. Is that?
Possession is 9/10 of the law. Mike Massetti, PBS Online NewsHour. I can't help myself from asking this question. Professor Zakharova's paper mentioned that one of the leading exports from North Korea to Russia was musical instruments. Is that Gangman North or something else going on? And slightly more seriously, the figures on North Koreans working overseas, I sort of totaled it up to about 50,000 this year. That didn't include the number possibly in Japan. Then, of course, that's a drop in the bucket compared with 10 million Filipinos working abroad. But are remittances any kind of an important element in the North Korean economy?
If we speak about Russian position, yes, of course. This labor, North Korean labor recruitment in Russia is a very important area of cooperation between the two countries. And of course, they are paid, so the North Korean regime gets the money, because as far as I know, they aren't paid directly. So it's a very important area of cooperation. And speaking about musical instruments, yeah, it's a funny item, but it's not big. And this year, I don't think we see this on the trade items between the two countries. But yes, there are like pianos or something like this, which was going from North Korea to Russia. There are several times that I have mentioned several times in their trade statistics. Actual pianos, and the funny thing is that if you look at the Russian statistics, the trade items names, number two will be nuclear reactors. And I always laugh at it because it's the category, just the category of the Russian statistics, meaning some machinery.
Oh, no, that's just the SITC category. It's possible. Nuclear reactors and
the machinery, yes. So, but it's one of the main experts on North Korea to Russia.
I'm Peter Humphrey. I'm an intelligence analyst, occasional professor, and former diplomat. Wondering, given that North Korea can always lower the price of its minerals because so much of the mineral industry is dependent on literal slave labor, how can we see a diminution in mineral exports to China, since they can always underbid any competitor who might be supplying those same minerals? That's puzzling to me, and I'm wondering if I'm missing something here. And can you tell me also, are they paying in renminbi or are they paying in dollars, the Chinese, for the North Korean minerals?
I think dollars and renminbi, case by case, because a lot of those transactions are not are going through cash because of the past sanctions. And I'm not sure about the ratio here, but I think the renminbi should be the majority, yeah.
Just a quick self-referential comment. I did some analysis of the prices that China was paying for commodities which are essentially undifferentiated, and they were paying slightly below, world market reference prices for North Korean mineral exports, interestingly.
So why would those minerals be down? Is it just
because of
the Chinese economy?
No, the reason they're down is twofold. There's a volume effect and there's a price effect in the total data that you see there. And so part of what North Korea is actually experiencing is the end of the commodity price super cycle. And so a lot of the downturn isn't in the volume of trade between the two countries, it's in the prices. And so this is another reason why I really think that distress is potentially on the horizon, because it's not just a question of the volume of trade between the two countries, it's the fact that the prices of these commodities are falling. And so North Korea is vulnerable on this score, just like other commodity exporters are globally.
Yeah.
In the back there, please.
Hi. I'm doing an internship in the Millennium Project, so our organization is really interested in the future things. So I'm curious about Troy's presentation. In your presentation, there are potential futures about. So you explained about five futures. So, but after they change in the North Korea, the leader is changed. So he did some. Met so many unexpected behaviors these days. So, in your opinion, what is the possible future you think about in the presentation you mentioned? You know what I mean.
So, in essence, what I was trying to do is we're at a point now to where we have all these new sanctions in place, and I wanted to try to think it through in terms of where things could go, because we could have complete implementation by all countries involved, and even U.S. resources or other countries' resources to help other countries who have, we'll say, less capacity to take and enforce sanctions, to take and create a full sanctions regime. The question we need to sort of ask ourselves is, how much is the program worth to the North Koreans? if this is an existential identity kind of thing to where they're, you know, and Jonathan Pollock has argued this, that since the beginning of the regime, they've been developing this program and that it is innate to the regime. And if that's the case, then, you know, they're going to evaluate very deeply and we could be in for a period of, you know, long-term sanctions to where the regime remains isolated and the sanctions are in place. Now, that being said, there are other possibilities. You know, North Korea could decide for its own reasons that, okay, it's time to enter the talks again, and perhaps we do reach a negotiated solution. And that is what the goal of the United States, China, and others are. But the other possibilities are, you know, in the long-term sanctions possibility, you know, as we saw with Iraq and other countries, the longer sanctions are in place, the more likely you are to see leakage and goods being smuggled in, countries to not enforce them as well. So we need to be prepared for that as well. And then you have, you know, there's one other possibility other than the end of the regime that I'm blanking on at the moment. But in essence, I wanted to try and draw out what those possibilities were. Oh, it was policy shift, that you could have a policy shift in either South Korea or one of the other countries that then leads to a change in our approach to North Korea. Now, the reason I raise all this is that because I think what we want to avoid is that if we return to a situation where there's economic engagement with the North, that we don't find ourselves in the same situation again where we are now, to where, you know, we have concerns about the nuclear program, we have concerns about funds going into the programs from our economic engagement projects. And so if we're going to take and realize that we don't know what the future holds, that means we also need to prepare for what the different possibilities are. And so in that context, thinking about, you know, okay, if the politics of this changes, if the North Korean regime engages in steps that allow us to take, make this change, then we need to think through, all right, so what types of things should we be doing and how should we be doing them? Because if you simply took and engage in, you know, like let's, for example, say, you know, Mount Kumgong and it gets reopened, you know, for the North Korean regime, there's potential to earn a significant amount of hard currency, but there's very little impact on North Korea beyond that. So we have to ask ourselves, do we want to engage in those types of projects in the future, things that provide the regime with significant revenue, but we haven't seen a lot of change within the regime? You know, or do we want to take, and you know, I talked about very briefly at the end because I was going over, you know, small-scale things that might help the populace and that might help other parts of the country as well. So, you know, people who live in rural areas that have no access to electricity, who clearly are not part of the regime and the elite, but that, you know, if we provide solar cells to, they might be able to take, have hot water, which would improve health because then you could bathe, you could cook food properly, and things of that nature. So I think, you know, we need to think through all of these different aspects of things because we don't know what future we're going to go to. And our goal, obviously, is to take and eliminate the nuclear program and then also to take and reform North Korea in a way to where its economy is reformed, the populace and the human rights improve in terms of their health and other things. And so we need to think about it in all of that context.
Troy, thanks. I think we'll have to call it a day. Most of us will be around. If anyone wants to come up, we're willing to continue the conversation. But thanks for turning out on a nice day in Washington and listening to North Korea.